Hey, and welcome back. I'm Robert Breaker, missionary evangelist to the Spanish and English-speaking people. And this week's sermon, what I thought I'd do is I'd just give a bit of testimony. Before, I have given my testimony of salvation. That's one of the probably third, fourth, fifth, something like that, sermon that I've given. You can go back to thecloudchurch.org and look that up. See my testimony of how I got saved. Faith in the blood of Jesus Christ, trusting the shed blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, faith in the gospel. And I've actually had several people contact me and say, man, thank you for that. I got saved watching that testimony. And I thought, wow, amen, what a blessing. And through many of the videos that I've done online through the Cloud Church, a lot of people have contacted me and said, we got saved watching your videos. There's a lot of good videos, doctrine of blood atonement, the doctrine of justification, the doctrine of imputed righteousness. Many, many videos which I've made. And that was the goal. That was the hope, that people would watch those videos and get saved. Well, I've also seen in my time in the ministry, and I've been preaching since I was 18 years old, 23 years, if my math is correct, I've been in the ministry doing the work of the Lord. And I've had people contacting me lately. We even had a missionary come and visit. And he said, what do I need to do? I believe the Lord would have me go to the Philippines as a missionary. Pray for him. But I've had him and other people asking me, you've been in the ministry. You've been in the mission field. What do I need to do? How do I get into the ministry? Well, that's what I want to do today. I want to give my testimony of how I got into the ministry and how God called me. And I want to tell you, not really so much what I've done for the Lord, because that would be bragging on me, and I don't want to brag on myself. I would like to just kind of tell you what the Lord has done with me. I had an old friend one time who was a missionary, and he said he went to a church, and he was so humble. This preacher was so humble. And he said the preacher stood up and said, okay, brother so-and-so, come preach, and you tell us what you're doing for the Lord. And that preacher got up there and said, pastor, I'm sorry I have to disobey. I'm sorry I have to tell you that you're wrong. But if you want me to come up here and tell you what I'm doing for the Lord, he said, I'm just a Jehu. If you don't know who Jehu is, look in the Old Testament. He said, that would be just me bragging about myself. He said, pastor, if it's okay with you, I'd like to tell the people about what Jesus is doing with me so that we give God the honor and the glory. And he said it like this. He said, so we can tell people what God's doing with a great big nobody like me. Oh, I love that, brother. Well, that's what I want to do today. I would like to tell you how God can use a great big nobody like me and how he got me into the ministry, what he did to put me into the ministry to do his work, and how. In the hopes that maybe you're trying to get into the ministry, maybe this will help you. And what I'd like to do is go to 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 12 and read what the Apostle Paul said. Now, not everybody's cut out for the ministry. Some people are, some people aren't. But whether you are or you're not, the truth of the matter is, you are called by God to preach the gospel. Whether you're a layman or a missionary or a pastor, whether you're a man or a woman, you are to present the gospel to the lost and show them how to be saved. That is your job. That is what God calls every Christian to do. Now, no, a woman shouldn't preach in the pulpit, but that doesn't mean she can't go to work with her Bible with her and during break time say, hey, can I show you what the Bible says here in 1 Corinthians 15, 1-4? So it is the job of every Christian to try to win souls to Jesus Christ. But not every Christian is actually put into the ministry as a missionary or a pastor or an evangelist or as a deacon or, if I'm missing one, elder, bishop, pastor, deacon. Not everyone is called to be an evangelist or a missionary. So let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 12 and see what Paul says about this. In 1 Timothy 1:12, Paul says, and I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who hath enabled me, for that he hath counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. So we have three things here. Three things Paul says about the ministry. And what are those three things? He said, God enabled me. He said, he counted me faithful. And then he said, he put me into the ministry. Make sure I got that right. Enabled me, counted me faithful, and he put me in. So this is the way that God set it up. If a man is by God called into the ministry, then that man must be enabled. And God enables him. How does God enable him? By teaching him, by showing him. You know, one of the best things I've learned over the years is it's not enough to just know the Bible. You need to have experience. And the older you get, the more experience you get. And so God gave Paul the enabling and enabled him. And then the Bible says he counted him faithful. I remember the verse where Jesus said, faithful in little, faithful in much. You don't go out as a minister like Jonah and convert a whole city in one day, like it appears Jonah did. No, you got to be faithful in little. There's a lot of ministers I've met that aren't faithful in anything. Are they truly ministers? It's a good question. See, if you'll just be happy serving God and allowing Him to bless you little by little, the more faithful you are to God, the more faithful He'll be to you and give you more and give you more and give you more people to reach with the truth. A lot of ministers don't understand that. They're not faithful. And then God will put you in. If God wants you to be a minister, an evangelist, a pastor, a missionary, whatever God wants, He will do. But you got to do it. I heard a preacher say one time, he said, it's like driving a car. He said, if you're just sitting in the car, try turning the wheel. It's hard to turn the wheel on a car that's not moving. It's just sitting there. But he said, if you're driving, it's really easy to turn the wheel. So what he was saying was, if you're doing the work of God, which is winning souls and passing out tracts and telling others about Jesus, and He wants you in the ministry, well, you're already going, already doing, then it's easy for God to say, now this is where I want you. But I've met some Christians just sit around and just go, well, I'm just waiting for the calling and the enabling. I'm just waiting for God to do it. Like a bump on a log, just sitting there, hoping God will somehow mystically pick them up and put them to work. No, you got to be working for God to continue to show you where to go. Well, many churches, they preach, are you called to preach? Are you called to preach? And they preach so hard on are you called to preach that I've met many people in many churches that I've visited that say, Brother Breaker, I'm not called to preach. And I say, so what are you doing for Jesus? Nothing. I say, wait a minute. Don't tell me you're not called to preach. God told, and through Paul, said that we're supposed to preach to everyone. You don't have to be a pastor or an evangelist or a missionary or a deacon. If you are saved and you are a Christian, you should be trying to win people to Jesus by taking your Bible and showing them the gospel and passing out tracts. Don't give me this garbage, I'm not called to preach. Every Christian is called to preach the gospel. Now, you might not be called to the ministry. That's something different. But many Christians have taken this excuse, I'm not called to preach, as an excuse to do nothing. That's wrong. Every Christian should do something. And the more you do, it just might be that's God enabling you. And the more you do, the more He just might count you faithful and then just put you right in. I get so tired. I remember one church in particular in Alabama. I went and stayed with this family and this young man. Just kept saying, Brother, I'm just not called to preach. And he just kept putting his head down because he'd heard in church from his pastor so many times, you're not called to preach, you're not called to preach. And he was so sad. And I finally just said, Brother, stop it. You are called to preach because every Christian is supposed to preach the gospel. Now, what you may not be called is to the ministry, but you are called to preach. Don't let anyone fill your head with those lies so that you don't do anything for Jesus. The truth is, every Christian should preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the more faithful we are at it, the more He just might put us in to the ministry. Well, that's what God did with me. He put me into the ministry. I was saved on July 29th, 1992. Several months later, I was out on a street corner preaching the gospel. I belonged to a church during that time that every Saturday they'd go out and preach on the street. I love to preach on the street. It's fun. You just basically, a lot of people have emailed and say, how do you street preach? Well, you hold your Bible up. So a lot of times you go to a stoplight. That's the best place. People have their windows down. You say, the Bible says, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. Jesus Christ said you must be born again. Paul said, I declare unto you, and just repeat verses. That's all you have to do. And hopefully, God will touch the heart of those people, and they'll be like, wow, and you've planted a seed. No, they don't get saved through their car window, but there's a seed planted that might blossom thereafter. So there's nothing wrong with street preaching unless you do it the wrong way, which is like I've seen some men do. I've seen some men on a hot summer in Pensacola, Florida, preaching in a street corner, and a convertible comes up with a car full of half-naked women in their bikinis, and he starts screaming, "You bunch of whores! You sluts! You bunch..." And I'm just like, yeah, they're really going to get saved, aren't they? Is that planting a seed? Yeah, but it's a bad seed. It's planting a seed to them that, oh, Christians are hateful, mean people. I don't ever want Jesus. So stick with the Bible. That's what it's all about. God enables you and counts you faithful and puts you in. But the ministry is all about ministering to people, not attacking and name-calling and putting them down, especially lost folks. So God put me into the ministry. Now, right after I got saved, I went 1 year to a secular college in Pensacola. And I remember going to that secular college, and the whole year that I was in that secular college, I kept thinking, I don't want to be here. I don't want to be here. This is gross. This is disgusting. This bothers me. Because, as most colleges, the first thing they do was attack God and the Bible and try to make you believe that there's no God. And I remember going into that main building where they have the food. I don't know what they call it nowadays. It's been so long since I've been to college. You know, the place where all the kids come around and they have pool tables and they have ping pong and all that. And I remember going into this building, and I looked around, and everywhere you saw it said, global this, global that, global this. And I scratched my head and said, what is global? And I walked over, and somebody gave me a little pamphlet, and they said, here, take this. And I looked down, and it said G-L-O-B-A-L, and it's all periods after each one. It said, the Gay Lesbian Organization of Bisexual Alliance, or I don't even know what it was. And I went, ah! And what they were doing was actually recruiting people to join their global organization. But it wasn't global for a global one world order. It was a global, hey, or join our gay, lesbian, bisexual organization. And as a Christian, I said, that ain't right. I don't think I should be in a place like this that is openly spitting on the Word of God and spitting in the face of God and openly embracing sin and trying to recruit people to it. I said, I can't do this. About that time, an old friend of my dad's had moved back here to this area and started Bible school over in Pensacola. And he was a year ahead of me, and we'd sit down and we'd talk about all the things that he'd learned, and I just ate it up. I said, wow, he's learning the scriptures. And about that time, my dad said, well, son, why don't you go to that school? Why don't you go there? It's a 3-year school. Why don't you go there? So after my first year of this secular university, I said, you know what? I've had enough of the world's wisdom. The Bible tells us that it's evil. This Bible says there's a wisdom from above and a wisdom from below. And they were trying to give me the wisdom from below. So I said, I'll do it. Now my dad said, okay, if you go to that Bible school, he said, sit in the back and keep your mouth shut. And as soon as you graduate, get out of there. I wish I'd listened to my dad, but that's either here or there. But there were some things going on in that school. Even though it was probably the greatest Bible school in the world, there were some things going on there that my dad had seen when he went there as a student. He didn't graduate, by the way, but he did audit classes. And he was right. There were some things going on that I didn't need to be a part of. But I didn't learn that till later. All I knew was God wanted me to serve Him, and I wanted to do right. I wanted to learn. I wanted to be enabled. I wanted someone to teach me the Bible. Boy, probably the greatest Bible teacher that ever lived, besides the Apostle Paul, was the head of that school. So I went to Bible college from 1995 to 1998, and I graduated in 1998. And then 2 weeks later, after graduating, I went to Honduras for almost 3 months to help a missionary there because I believed that the Lord had called me to Honduras, or was calling me to Honduras. Now let me back up and explain that a little bit. While I was in Bible school, while you're there, They're teaching you the Bible for a purpose so that God would call you to the ministry. Now, not everybody that goes to Bible school ends up in the ministry. But in my class, there were many men that volunteered to be missionaries. One to Africa, one to Spain, one to New York, one here, one there. None of them are missionaries today. I think maybe one made it and didn't stay very long. That was really sad. I was the only one that made it to the mission field and stayed for quite a long period of time. And so I prayed about it, and while I was in Bible school, the last year, the pastor there preached a message. And the pastor preached a message on God will use what you have in your past. And he preached about Peter and how Peter was a fisherman. And God said, Peter, follow me, I'll make you a fisher of men. So God will always use what you have in your past if you'll just surrender it to Him. I went down the altar, got on my knees, and said, God, I had 4 years of Spanish in high school, and I know it wasn't much. And I know I probably didn't learn hardly anything except the bad words. You know how that is when you're lost. But I said, if you want to use this, God, it's up to you. It's yours. I surrender. I surrender all. I surrender you to you this, if you want to use me as a missionary in this capacity to go and preach in another language the gospel of Jesus Christ. I can't remember if it was a week or 2 weeks later. There was a friend of my dad's who was a missionary to Honduras. And he came up to me in church and said, I've been talking to your dad. He says, you're praying about being a missionary. He says, I'm going to Honduras as a missionary. He says, when you graduate, you come visit me. And I was like, huh? What? He goes, yep, you do it. I said, okay, I'll pray about it. I mean, I'm not going to do something just because some guy told me to. But I get to pray about it. And then everywhere I'd go, it's Honduras this. I'd go to a store, I'd meet somebody from Honduras. Honduras this, Honduras that. I was like, I couldn't get away from Honduras. And so the pastor, after he had preached the message on God, we use on what you have in your past, and I was going to quote Mark 1:7, Jesus said, come ye after me and I'll make you fishers of men. You know, God used Peter and what he had in his past to be a fisher of men. Well, after he had talked to me about Honduras, I was praying about it and asked the Lord what to do. And I was going through my daily Bible reading, and a lot of people have asked me through emails, is how do you know God's talking to you? Well, there's no voice that shouts down from heaven, okay? Those days are gone. We see in Peter that we have a more sure word of prophecy, the Bible. So the way God speaks to us today is through His Word. And we read it, and we read it, and we read it, and eventually something will jump out that's just like, wow, that's an answer from God. And that's what happened to me. I was praying and praying because, I mean, I'd go to church and people say, well, Brother Breaker, when are you going to Honduras? I'm like, well, shut up! I couldn't get away from Honduras. Leave me alone! I never said I'd go. And so I began praying and praying and said, Lord, there seems to be an open door here to Honduras. Is that where you'd want me to go as a missionary? And I was reading my Bible, really searching and praying. Can't remember if I fasted. I probably did. And asking God, what do you want me to do? Do you want me to go? Do you want me to go? Well, I go to 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and begin reading in verse 10. You see, this was the year before I graduated from college, from Bible school. And it says there, and herein I give my advice, for this is expedient for you who have begun before not only to do, but also to be forward a year ago. It was like God was reminding me. Remember a year ago when you went down the altar and said, God, here's the 4 years I had in Spanish, you know, it's yours, I surrender. And then a week or two later, the missionary says, when you graduate, come to Honduras. Well, here, a year had passed. And I said, And then it says, verse 11, and I was praying, well, Lord, do you want me to go to Honduras? And then I read verse 11, now therefore perform the doing of it, that as there was a readiness to will, so there may be a performance also out of that which ye have. For if there be first a willing mind, it is accepted according to that a man hath, and not according to that he hath not. I believe that night the pastor preached on, are you willing? And he preached on willingness. And he preached to you, are you willing to go, but are you willing to stay? You know, some people want to go to the missionary because they get paid to go somewhere else. Woo, wow. You know, it's not a job, it's a calling. Unfortunately, I've met some missionaries, that's all they care about is the paycheck, unfortunately. But it's not about that. It's about willingness, and it's about getting into the ministry and doing what God would have you to do. Well, God enabled me by putting me in Bible school, and I wanted to be faithful to Him. So I surrendered all, and I was faithful throughout time in Bible school, preaching on the street, passing out tracts, trying to win people to the Lord. And that's when God put me in. Actually, in Bible school. When I was in Bible school, there's a church up the road from us, Garson Point Baptist Church. And that church had been closed for years, and my dad kept saying, son, you need to go and ask for the keys of that church. I said, Dad, I'm in Bible school. He said, you need to go ask for the keys. Well, I kept saying, no, I'm in Bible school. And so my dad went and got another man, who was an old friend of ours, talked to him about it. And this man says, you know what, I will go ask for the keys of that church and be the pastor there, but he said, only if your son will be the co-pastor. And I said, I guess that's an open door. So for 5 months, maybe six, something somewhere in there, in Bible school, I pastored, co-pastored at first, but then this guy left halfway through, so left me to be pastor for several months, the Garson Point Baptist Church. Now, there are some people on the internet that lie about others. You can actually go to documents on the internet now by liars that lie and say, Robert Breaker has never pastored Garson Point Baptist Church. The reason is they tore the church down several years after I left. But I've got some pictures. I guess what I'll do is I'll scan a picture of the sign that my dad and I designed for the front of the church and show some pictures of the church, just for those gainsayers and liars that say, You know, he never pastored that church. When I did, when the Lord allowed me to anyway. We saw a couple people get saved. But it was just, when you're in school trying to pastor as well, it was too hard. So like I said, only 5-6 months, and I turned it over to another man. And I think he probably ran it into the ground. That's why the building was torn down later. But that was an experience. That was something God used to teach me how to be a pastor. And being a pastor is more than just preparing a message every Sunday. It's ministering to others. Every house in this area where I live, over 2,000 homes, while I was pastor of that church, I visited every single house, left a gospel tract. And some people, I gave them a Bible. And I ministered to them. I saw what they needed. What were their needs? And part of being a pastor is understanding what the needs of people are. Today on the Cloud Church, people contact me with questions, Bible questions. And I minister to them by emailing them back or sending them letters trying to answer their question, trying to help them, trying to edify them. So that was a great opportunity in Bible school to pastor the Garson Point Baptist Church. Well, then I graduated from the Bible school. And 2 weeks later, I was on a plane to Honduras. Now, the man that was the pastor of the church, I went to him a couple weeks before and I said, "Brother so-and-so, this brother over here that's sent out of our church is a missionary over here and he's asked me to come because I believe the Lord wants me to be a missionary over here in Honduras." And I said, "The price of the ticket will be $680. I remember the exact price to this day. And that pastor of that church said, "Brother, we will pay for that ticket." Well, I never got a check. I'm still waiting to this day. If God should lay on their heart, well, that pastor's dead now, so I guess I'll never get the check. But you know, it's not about the money. I worked really hard and earned the price of that ticket. And I didn't even know. Well, he just said they're going to, well, who do I go and say, "Hey, give me a check"? I didn't even push it. I didn't care. It's not about the money. I worked hard and sacrificed to buy that plane ticket to Honduras. Went there for three months. And I was able to lead a young lady named Ava to the Lord. I was able to learn what a missionary is and what a missionary does. This missionary got out every single day and knocked on doors. I learned later, we went to some of the poorest places where people were killing each other in the streets. And I was with him. I felt safe. I didn't realize these were a bunch of murderers all around us and thieves. We were just telling them about Jesus, trying to tell them how to get saved. And I worked with that missionary for 3 years, came back. And my dad had a house up in Wyoming at the time, so I flew up to Wyoming and told Dad all about, "Wow, God used me for 3 months and showed me what a missionary is." I said, "But I don't know what to do." I said, "You know, maybe God wants me there, maybe He doesn't. I don't know." My dad says, "Okay, well, let's go to church on Sunday." So we went to church on Sunday, and my dad went up to the pastor and said, "This is my son, just got back from a mission trip in Honduras. They call it a survey trip, and he's praying about going to Honduras." Well, the pastor said, "Well, I'm going to put my Sunday school on hold till next week, and you come up and tell us what the Lord's done with you." And so I got the whole Sunday school hour talking about being put into the ministry. And afterwards, a woman came up and gave me a check. It was not a lot, you know, maybe $40, $50. And she said, "That will help you get back to Honduras as a missionary." And I was like, "I guess this is what the Lord wants." So we came back home. I went back to my home church that I was a member of, and I told them about it. And I've got all this on my old website, rb3.com, some of the things that I went through. Like I said, my dad said there's some things going on in that church that I should have gotten away from, and I probably should have. I probably should have just picked up and gone to Honduras by myself. But at the time, I thought, well, you have to have a mission board and all this stuff. So I got on the mission board, and the church sent me out. I began to do deputation and preach and teach. For 3 years, I did what they call deputation. That's traveling to different churches, showing them the ministry God's giving you and asking them to support you so much every month. And that's what I did. And then after three years, I went to Honduras as a missionary, where I was there for about 7 or 8 years. And I was a single man. I was not married yet. People kept telling me, "Maybe you'll get married in Honduras, maybe." And I kept going, "No, I don't know. No, I'm from America. I would like to get married to an American, but I'm going to leave that in God's hand. I'm going to put that in hold. It's up to Him. I'm praying and asking Him." Well, lo and behold, God sent me someone to be my wife, and she said, "I'll marry you." So I flew back from Honduras to Washington State to get married. And as soon as we got there, she went, and basically told me the week that I was there that she changed her mind, she didn't want to get married and all this stuff. And I said, okay, praise God, all right. Went back home to Florida, kind of suffered a little bit. Went, you know, it's hard when you go through things like that. You're praying and expecting God to send you the right one, and it doesn't work out. I went back to Honduras, just kept getting busy in the work of the Lord, because not only had He enabled me and counted me faithful, but He put me in the ministry. So I'm in the ministry in Honduras, and the Lord has allowed me to start two churches there. Quebrada de Lajas is one of the churches. The other is in La Colonia El Tejar. And there's two churches still going today, some men that I've trained and taught the Bible. And they're still going on to this day. And I just thank God for the opportunity to be there. So many things that I could talk about. I could go into the Spanish Bible issue and how God showed me the right Spanish Bible. There's a lot of fake Spanish Bibles out there, but God gave me the right one. And a lot of these people that use these other Spanish Bibles that aren't as good, all they do is attack you. And you can even go to YouTube and probably find, or internet, and Google Robert Breaker and find all these lies against me from people that hate me because I don't use the Spanish Bible they do. Well, I've read the Spanish Bible they do. I've read verse by verse. I've actually translated the whole New Testament into Spanish from the King James using all the old Spanish Bibles. 1569, 1602, 1543, New Testament, all these, and the Encinas, 1556, Juan Perez de Pineda. So I've done all that. You can't tell me that your Bible is the perfect Word of God when I've read it and compared it to the King James and these others, and yours reads more like an RSV. I'm King James only in English, bless God. I'm King James only in Spanish. So I thank God that God sent me and enabled me and put me in the ministry and helped me to find the right church in Monterrey, Mexico that puts out the Valera 1602 Purified, a pure Spanish Bible. That's why I don't use the Gomez Bible or any of those other ones that still have problems that weren't fixed, even though they claim to be. And that's why you'll find people preaching against Robert Breaker, because I don't follow the Bible they use. Because I've read the Bible they use, and I see errors and I see problems in that Bible. And the purest Bible I can find is the Valera 1602 Purified, so I accept that. Well, as I was in the ministry, I began to learn about the ministry. And let me back up. The first day in Bible school in Pensacola, they have their orientation. And the first day in orientation in Bible school, they tell you this. The people that will hurt you most in the ministry are other ministers and other Christians. I remember sitting there with these other guys and looking around kind of laughing. You know, we're all new in the Lord and love God, and we're kind of, yeah, Christians hurting other Christians. How funny. Christians just love everybody. It's all love, love, love. No. There's a lot of jealousy in the ministry. There's a lot of men who want to be a big name for themselves, so they act like a bunch of little tiny dogs and go bark against the big dogs. And they want people to recognize them. They don't understand that they need to be enabled and counted faithful before God puts them in. There's a lot of young men who's trying to be in the ministry, and they think the ministry is, well, I'm going to go around and tell everybody who the heretics are. And you know, you're a heretic. Now go listen to me because I have the truth. Yeah, how long have you been saved? One whole year? Yeah, good luck with that, buddy. I guess I've been in the ministry now, if my math's correct, about 23 years. But it's not about me. It's about Jesus. It's about what the Bible says. And I've learned in the ministry that there are those that claim to be ministers that are in the flesh rather than the spirit, and they want to attack. And so part of my ministry was try to get away from those people and get away from their attacks. God didn't call me to attack other Christians. He called me to win the lost and to edify those that are saved by teaching them the Bible. You see, Christianity is supposed to be the good fight of faith. We as Christians are supposed to be in a line pointing at the enemy with our weapons, the King James Bible, and preaching against the evil in this world. But unfortunately, because the Bible says we're in the last days, unfortunately a lot of Christians, all they do is shoot each other. But here the Bible teaches that we're in the last days and we're in this time of apostasy. And as I started the ministry, going out and preaching in about 1999. Because I graduated from school in 98. Started in 95. So from 99 until today, I was active in the ministry, preaching in churches and things like that. Before that, I'd preached on the street, and like I said, in Bible school, had pastored a small church. But from 1999 to today, this is 2016 as I do this, it's so sad for me to report that I've seen so much apostasy, so much falling away. Many of the ministers I used to know and believe in and love, that preached the truth and stood for what's right, have fallen away. They're liberals. They have fallen away from the doctrines of the truth. And so just in my short ministry, I've seen so much of this falling away, this apostasy, and it bothers me. Well, yet I continued as a missionary there in Honduras and came back and got married. This time she wanted me, so I said, praise God. I came back, we married her, came back to Honduras. She was there with me for a couple years. And we couldn't seem to get her residency. And we couldn't seem to stay in Honduras as long as I wanted to. Well, God had already planted two churches and already used me in many ways to train 6, 7, 8 different men. And by the way, let me just explain this. If you go to rrb3.com, my old website, I'd like to update this someday, but it's made with such old technology I can't change anything on it. rrb3.com is my old website. You can go there and find my Honduran journal. And on that website, I kept a journal of everything that happened every single day for something like 6, 7 years while I was in Honduras as a missionary. All the people that got saved, everything I did, where I visited, the names of the towns. I mean, I went way away to towns, little villages, way close to El Salvador. I even crossed into El Salvador a couple of times. So if you want to read that, you can. It's still on the internet. People who read it said, wow, that's amazing, some of the things that you've done and what the situations that you've got in. One time I went to San Pedro Sula with another missionary, and two guys broke into our house with guns and stole everything we have. And we heard them call on the phone, because they were members of a gang, and say, do you want us to kill them? And the missionary's wife heard it. I didn't hear it. He said, yes, kill them all. Still alive today. Must be for a reason. But I still remember that laser pointing right at me of his gun. I remember him taking me in the bedroom, forcing me on my knees and putting the gun right here to the back of my head. And I remember praying, Lord, please don't let him miss, because I sure don't want to feel anything. And Lord, I'm thankful that now I get to come home, the sooner the better. Well, he put me in, and I guess he still has something for me, because that wasn't my last day. I'm still here today. I've been in places in Honduras where I'm on a bus, and I'm with another missionary there, and we're going to this little town, Don Lee, to preach. And I fell asleep against the window, and then all of a sudden I hear, pa-pow, 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 and I'm awakened by this other missionary say, Robert, down. He didn't speak very much English. We were always speaking in Spanish. But that's all he could say in English was, Robert, down. And I'm the only one on the bus. I'm looking around. Everybody's down on the floor. And I'm raising up to look out the window. And there's people shooting at each other back and forth. People say, you ever been in combat? Well, no. But then, kinda. I've been in situations where bullets are flying by your head. And we got down on the floor. And you heard slowly the bullets going more in that direction. And then the bus took off. So there were two groups fighting each other. And when they kind of went away and the bus driver thought it was safe, he said, I'm out of here. My wife and I, we went to a mall in San Pedro Sula one time. As soon as we get off the bus, we step down, and there about 4, 5, 6 feet away is a dead body with yellow tape around it, blood just everywhere pouring out of the body, bullet holes all rattled in it. What a thing to see when you get off a bus, especially with your brand new bride. So we kind of looked down and we're just like, that's my first thought was, that's why I'm here. People like that, when they die, they'll go to heaven and not hell. And that poor soul's probably in hell right now, because nobody reached them with the gospel. I've been in places like that. I know what it's like to have bullets whiz by you, see dead people. I've never been in combat, but I'm in the Lord's army. Amen. He enabled me. He put me in. I guess you could say I got drafted. Or maybe I enlisted. But he enabled me. He counted me faithful. He put me in. So the longer the time went on, it got really obvious that these works that we've started, the Lord used us to start, are going on by themselves pretty well. My wife and I, we couldn't get her documents in order to make her be able to stay in Honduras. So eventually we had to leave Honduras. And that's when the Lord started showing me, look, this was your experience as a missionary. Now it's time to work as an evangelist. And the Lord opened that door, and I'll get to that in a minute. But you know what? The Bible teaches, the Bible says about tradition, that the tradition makes the Word of God of none effect. there's a couple of traditions within the so-called church today that make the Word of God of none effect. The first one is a mission board. Now, I'm not against the mission board. If you're a missionary and you have a mission board, more power to you. But can you show me that in the Bible? You cannot. In Acts chapter 13, when they sent out missionaries, they sent them from the church. And the church laid hands on and ordained and sent out ministers. See, one of the reasons my wife and I had to leave our old church is because they wouldn't do that. When I was leaving after the 3 years of deputation to go to Honduras as a minister, I went to the assistant pastor of my old church and said, "Okay, I'm going as a missionary. I'm ready to be ordained." And he says, "Well, we don't do that here." I said, "What do you mean you don't do that here? That's what the Bible teaches." Acts 13, in verse 3, when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away as missionaries. And he says, "No, you go, you start a big work, and if it's good and it's big and we're in agreement with it, then you come back and we'll ordain you." I said, "Okay." And I walked away, scratching my head, going, "Huh? I thought we were Bible believers here. Why don't we do it the way the Bible says? Why don't we lay hands on and send them away?" Well, you say, "Well, are you ordained now?" Well, I'm triple ordained, I guess you could say. I went to a church in South Florida one time, preached there, and afterwards the pastor says, "Now everybody get down here and lay hands on him. We're going to pray and ordain him to send him forth." And they did. So that was down in South Florida. I've since joined a church in Mexico where I got ordained by a good church, a Bible-believing King James church, but they're Mexicans and they're Spanish-speaking people. They're the ones that put out the right Bible, the Valera 1602 Purified. And also, I've got ordained another way. I had a friend that said, "I want to get married and I want you to marry me." I said, "Well, I'm ordained, but one of the times I got ordained, they didn't give me papers. The other papers I have are in Mexico. They gave them to me." He says, don't worry. "Nowadays, you can go on the internet and be ordained like that." And he paid something like $25, and I received in the mail these ordination papers. So I'm ordained by the so-and-so whatever church. Who knows what they are. But I was able to do his wedding ceremony for him. So, I'm triple ordained. How about that? How interesting is that? And so God used that and allowed me to do some great things in Honduras. And then he closed the door slowly on that. And he showed me, "Here's what I want you to do. More of the work of an evangelist." And so I started out serving the Lord. Well, during that time, some things were happening in our old church. And we decided, you know what? It's time to leave. I don't want to go into that. That's water under the bridge. I'm so glad that's under the bridge and over with. Unfortunately, there's some very evil and wicked men that like to bring up some stuff that's not even true and lie about you. And they do, and it's a shame. And we'll just say, God bless them. Amen. But still, they put their stuff on the internet, and if you read that, you might just think it's true. You might even make a video about it and pretend that it's really true. Just fine. Help yourself. That's called gossip and slander, by the way. You probably shouldn't engage in those sins. But anyway, there are people that would like to just attack others. And that's something I don't understand. If you're a minister, why would you attack another minister? Isn't that the opposite of ministering? You see, ministering is helping the needs of others, not attacking and putting others down. So it makes me wonder if they really are ministers who just live to attack other Christians and their ministries. But you can go to the Cloud Church, or excuse me, rrb3.com, and somewhere on there I have why we left our old home church. And I think it's important. Because I preach the doctrine of salvation, something that I learned in Bible school, and it's by faith alone in the blood atonement of Jesus Christ. And when you see people starting to change what they used to preach, I can't go along with it. So my wife and I, we decided to leave that church. And when we did, we prayed for a long time and said, "What would you have us to do, dear Lord?" And God sent us to this church in Mexico. And I started out as a missionary evangelist to the Spanish-speaking people. As an ordained minister, ordained by Spanish-speaking people to Spanish-speaking people. And the Lord used me to go around. Now, I started telling you about tradition. One of the things we saw was that, number one, you're not a missionary unless you have a mission board. Well, I'm sorry, but they're not in the Bible. You're sent from a church, not from a board. Number two, there are people today that believe a missionary is someone that's sent to one place for the rest of their life. I knew a guy one time that was a missionary to Ecuador or someplace like that. And he came back to the States and he says, "Well, God's used me here. I've started churches. I planted them. Now it's time for me to move on. And God's told me to move to Botswana, Africa." And you know what happened to that poor missionary? The church has told him, well, then you are a liar and we refuse to accept you and continue to support you. Because a missionary is someone that's sent only to one place for the rest of his life. Let me ask you a question. Who was Paul? Would you agree, Paul? Paul was a missionary? Yeah, I've known many ministers and I've never found one yet that said Paul wasn't a missionary. Okay? They even call his journeys missionary journeys. All right, so my question, who was Paul a missionary to? If Paul was the greatest missionary that ever lived, tell me what country was he a missionary to? But you see, the tradition of today is that a minister is only to a certain place. So I said for many years, I'm a missionary to Honduras, a missionary to Honduras. Well, then people said, oh, well, you're no longer in Honduras, then you're a liar. No, God can choose to use you anywhere, especially when he puts you in. So who was Paul a missionary to? What place did Paul go to as a missionary? You can't name one place, can you? Because Paul went to Macedonia. He went to Thessalonica. He went to Rome. He went to all these different places, Colossae. He went to Ephesus. Everywhere he went, he was a missionary. You see, the word missionary means one sent. Where is he sent to? Anywhere he goes. But you see, the tradition today makes the word of God of none effect in many ways because they say, oh, if you're a missionary, you can only go to one place for the rest of your life. Where's that in the Bible? A missionary is not just sent to one place. A missionary is sent to people. There are some missionaries, unfortunately, that don't get this. It's because they follow tradition rather than the Bible. And there's some missionaries that I've met that say, well, I'm a missionary to Germany. So when I'm in Germany, I pass out tracts and witness. But when I come back to America, I don't, because I don't have to. I've actually heard missionaries say that. Why would I think you're doing it in Germany if you're not doing it here? You see, you should be faithful. Faithful. So there are a lot of traditions that I've found in the church today that actually hurt missions rather than help missions. And one of them is saying that a missionary only goes to one single place for the rest of his life. When a missionary is not just to a place, he's to people. So God called me as a missionary evangelist to Spanish-speaking people. You say, why do you call yourself a missionary evangelist? Well, did you know the word missionary is not in the Bible? But did you know the Bible has the word evangelist? So why not use the Bible term? That's the way I look at it. And so that's what I use. Now, evangelize is to preach the gospel. Every message that I preach, I try to make sure to put the gospel in, so I'll make sure I put it in this one. The gospel is 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. That's what a missionary is supposed to take. You know how few missionaries I've met that actually take this gospel? A lot of missionaries are more interested in building their own kingdom than preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. One thing I saw on the mission field that made me sick, and I got away from it, was many mission groups go, first thing they do, they don't even have people, they build a building. And then the missionary writes back to his churches in America, I built a church. No, you didn't. You built an empty building with no people in it. So he takes and funnels and sucks all this money from America to build this gigantic building. And not one person's been saved yet, and not one person has gone into that building. Well, then they go out and visit. Hey, you need to come to our church. What are they doing? They're getting in the mind of the person the idea that the church is the building. No, sir. The church is the people. If you're a missionary and you're going to build churches, then you're getting people saved, and they are the church. And one thing I found is that if the missionary goes overseas and builds the big building, let me just draw the big building, once that missionary builds that huge building, you know what the people always think? Oh, that's the missionary's building. I put a cross on it just so you know it's not just a building, it's a church. And so the people always think, oh, that's the missionary's church. That's the missionary's building. You know what I did? Or God allowed me to do? Go out and win people to the Lord and then help them build their own building. And then they always felt like, this is our church building. This is ours. No, but many missionaries go and they spend all the money, they build it, it's theirs. The people have nothing invested in it, so they don't have to go there. And oftentimes they go for a little while and then leave. So you know what the missionaries do? Well, this Sunday we'll have Hot Dog Sunday. If you bring anybody who comes, we'll give you a hot dog. And people come for the hot dogs. But what if there's no hot dogs? Then nobody comes. And so oftentimes more money has to come if we're able to reach people. But they're not reaching people. They're just building buildings. They're not building saved people who are truly the church. And I saw a lot of things like that really bothered me. And I said, Lord, what I want to do, because I know this is what you'd have me to do, is to preach the gospel and reach as many people as I can with the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm so fed up with the traditions of this church today. Many churches put a steeple on top of their building. Did you know a steeple is an ancient pagan symbol that represents a phallic symbol? They use all these different things. You know, my dad used to say, modern churches today are nothing more than spiritual Catholics. Because that's what Catholics do. They go in, they build a big building, and they funnel money in and give to the poor so that the poor comes. If they don't give the money, the poor doesn't come. Then after tradition, years and years of people coming, they don't have to give them anymore. The people are accustomed to come to that building. And that's what many so-called Bible-believing churches are doing today. They become Catholic. And they're giving away hot dogs on Hot Dog Sunday. Or come this, you know, I heard in Honduras one time, these Mormons moved into this one area and they built a church building. And then in order to get people in, they opened up all the church building and they had liquor. They had beer, they had wine, they had vodka, they had all these different kinds of liquor. And they said, come to our one time only party. And they served fermented alcohol to anybody that came. And then from there, they pass out tracts. And then from there, they built their people. Does that sound right to you? Weird. We're living in crazy days. So I saw all this as a missionary, and I wanted to be a good missionary, a missionary of God, not a missionary of the world, and not a missionary that preaches tradition rather than the Word of God. And so God used me for many years in Honduras, about 7-8 years all total, and then traveling around as a missionary evangelist. And then in 2010, my dad passed away. And we had to put some things on hold and come and live here in this house. And take care of my grandmother, who was 89. She lived to be 94. And during that time, I'd do as much of the ministry as I could, but I needed to spend time with her and take care of her. She was getting old and getting dementia and all that. And so oftentimes that was hard on my wife. So part of my ministry wasn't just trying to reach the world and see people saved. Part of the ministry was, hey, family. You know, when I went to Bible school, the teacher, the main president of that Bible school, said, I'm going to tell you something right now. He said, I'm going to tell you this. He says, your wife comes before the ministry. He said, your wife is your ministry. And as long as she's happy, anything you do, then you can do for Jesus. I thought, wow. So your wife comes before the ministry. Well, that's what he taught. So family is important. So sometimes God puts family there for a reason. So we struggled. It was hard. But I was able to do as much of the ministry as I could, at the same time knowing I was doing the right thing, taking care of my grandmother. And I did. And then she passed away. Well, a year or so before she passed away, the Lord sent somebody our way. And we visit this brother and talk to him. And he said, well, I can't believe that you're not on the internet preaching yet. He says, you want to be a missionary evangelist and go all over preaching to everybody the gospel. He said, you don't have to go anywhere today to reach people. He said, if you'll just get on the internet, it'll reach so far and so wide, your head would spin. You can't believe how many people will hear the truth. So over a year and a half ago, I started this Cloud Church ministry. Began preaching on the internet. And we've been getting emails from people, thank you, Brother Breaker. People getting saved. People learning the Bibles. People getting the truth for the first time. People waking up, getting out of the Pentecostal church, getting out of the Catholic church. People learning the Bible and loving the Bible. And God's been taking us and using us in a mighty way. And I just give God the glory for everything that He's doing. And I want to continue doing the ministry that God has given me to do. And that's what we're doing. So many more things that I could say. But one thing that I'm learning about the ministry still, after 20-some years, is this one thing that I always tell many people. Did you know that the whole theme of the Bible is one man and God? If you look at a whole Bible, it starts out with one man, Adam. And as the Bible goes along, it seems like they always go into apostasy. And that's when God calls one man and uses that one man to preach the truth. Old Noah was that one man. Old Abraham, one man. The whole theme of the Bible is one man and God. Old Moses, God chose him. And all throughout the Bible, we have Peter show up. Then Paul. Put Paul way back where he belongs here. One thing I've learned in the ministry is you don't need all these other people. Most of the time, when a bunch of people get together, the first thing they do is kick God out. That's what the old Pharisees did under the law of Moses. When Jesus Christ, God manifested in the flesh, showed up, what did they do? They kicked him out and crucified him. So the whole theme of the Bible is one man fully surrendered to God and what God can do with that one man. That's amazing to me. So I want to be that one man. Now that doesn't mean I don't want to help of other people. I do. I want to work with others that love the truth. But I've learned that the church today is going into apostasy, and instead of preaching the truths of the Bible, they love to preach their own tradition rather than the Word of God. And I say, sorry, I can't go along with the apostasy. I have to stand with the truth. And so it became very clear to me that if I want to do the ministry, I'm going to have to search out others like myself. And they're hard to find. I had to go to Mexico to find a church that believes like I do, that is standing for the truth and wants the Word of God, and be sent and ordained from them. And then when I find them, I want to serve God. And I want to be used of God. I know that He's enabled me. He's counted me faithful. And He's put me into the ministry. I want to continue being faithful. Continue to be willing to do what God would have me to do. And I can't tell you how many, what a blessing it's been for this year. My wife and I sat down and read some emails and totaled up. It appears that between 2 to 3 people a month are getting saved through this ministry. And those are those that email us and let us know. Imagine how many people get saved and don't tell us. And so we're just excited. And we're just thanking God. And it's just an amazing thing and a wonderful way to reach others through this medium, preaching and teaching the gospel. And God has showed me many things in the ministry. And probably the greatest thing that God has showed me is don't worry about what other people think. When I started the ministry, and I was in Bible school, I started in 1995. I was 21 years old. I was a young man. I graduated in 98 and started preaching in pulpits. So what is that? 24-year-old kid preaching in churches. And people would always look at me and say, well, you're not married and you're too young. You'll never make it as a missionary and you'll never make it to the mission field. I did. So God can use anybody. Amen. And one thing that the Lord always gave me was this verse. Now watch this. 1 Timothy 4:12, let no man despise thy youth. You know, God can use you if you're young. But look at what the rest of the verse says, because one of the things I've learned in the ministry is that there are some mean, hateful, spirited brutes that call themselves ministers that are nothing more than dictators. God never called a minister to go put attack and name call and lamb blast others. That's not the ministry. The ministry is not, oh, there's another preacher. Oh, I'm going to attack him. But that's something that I've learned in the ministry. All people want to do is attack others. And I don't understand. I think it's probably jealousy is part of it. And I believe most of it is they're carnal. So part of being a minister is to remember to walk in the Spirit that you fulfill not the lust of the flesh. Because 1 Timothy 4:12 says, let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, okay, in conversation, gotcha. So I got to preach the word. I got to have a good way that I live, good demeanor, conversation. In charity, oh, there's the rub. In charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. One thing that I've learned 23 years in the ministry is that Paul is right. To be a true minister, you need to have some charity. A lot of ministers today don't. Why, you could go to YouTube and type in Robert Breaker and there'd be all this stuff that pops up. Well, he's a moron and he's an evil person. He's a liar and he's this and he's... What kind of person makes a video like that? Number one, someone that's in the flesh. Number two, someone that has no charity. And number three is someone who does not care about the gospel. Because they could have made a video about the gospel. But no, they choose to deny this verse. And this verse says, it's so plain, in spirit, in charity, and look what it says here, in purity, faith and purity. Now, if you get a chance and you want to see it, I preached a message on how Christians are supposed to treat other Christians not too long ago. That pretty much says it all. I took you through the words of Jesus Christ, the words of Peter, and the words of Paul, how we as Christians are supposed to reach other Christians. How are we as Christians supposed to treat other Christians? This right here. You know what the only thing that both Peter and Paul said was above all things is? I love to ask this question to other ministers now, after I saw this in the Bible. Both Peter and Paul said there is one thing for Christians that is above all things. What is that? 99% of all ministers I've ever asked that question to don't know the answer. Peter says, but above all things, charity. And Paul says, but above this, charity. So both Peter and Paul know what it is to be a minister. And they say the best minister is one that has charity. So if you want God to enable you into the ministry, you ought to have some charity. If you want God to look at you as a faithful minister, then have charity. If you want God to put you into the ministry, have some charity. God forbid that there be more people put in the ministry who think that they're called of God to go around and bark at others. God never called a man into the ministry to attack others, because that's not ministering. The fact of the matter is, ministering is edifying others and teaching them the Word of God. And so as I've been in the ministry, the one thing that I want to do is I want to do everything that I can to exalt the Lord Jesus Christ and edify other Christians while I seek to evangelize the lost. That's the ministry. So I'm done with all these people that, you know, well, you're this, and they write dirty things about you and lie about you and slander you. That's fine. They can help themselves. I was there. I know what happened. You don't have to lie and say I never pastored a church when I did. You know, I put the picture up. Matter of fact, right here, here's the picture. Here's the church sign that my dad and I, you know. So people will lie about you. And that was actually the first thing that they were taught us when we went to Bible school, is the people that hurt you most in the ministry are other Christians. So part of the ministry today that God's given me is try to help Christians to love one another. I had a friend come over the other day, and we had some hot dogs out front. And we're sitting there, and he was telling me about his church. And he says, brother, he said, my church, he said, is a good church. You know what it is? I said, what is it, brother? He goes, it's a ministry for hurt Christians. I said, well, tell me about it. He says, well, a lot of Christians used to go to this one church here. They've all been attacked and lied about and ridiculed and name-called and put down. And they've left church, and they sit around like this, and they just say, why are Christians so mean? And he said, our pastor, he just wants to edify. He just wants to teach and preach to others. I said, well, that's good. That's good. Isn't that a shame that there has to be ministries like that? People should just treat each other good. My old pastor one time, he said, the job of a minister is to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable. I thought that was good. Comfort the afflicted. There's a lot of affliction out there, a lot of afflicted people. Part of being a minister is comforting them with the Word of God. But when someone gets so comfortable that they openly live in sin and do whatever they want, that's when you have to afflict them by good, hard preaching from the Word of God so they'll feel bad and be convicted of their sin. So the ministry isn't easy. It's hard to know, when do I preach hard and land blast and get loud and preach hard against sin? And when do I comfort with charity and purity and try to be good to people? You see, when Jesus was here, he went to the Pharisees and he looked at them. And oftentimes the Bible says he could see their heart. He knew whether they would believe the truth or not. He knew if their heart was hardened. And there were many times in the Bible when Jesus gave a swift rebuke to these Pharisees, and they deserved it. But that's because he saw their heart. You know, there's a lot of ministers today that think they're Jesus. And they think that they, just like Jesus, have to go around and give a swift rebuke to everybody. Well, let me ask you, can you see my heart? Is that what I need? Maybe. Some people say yes. Some people say no. I can't see your heart, so I got to follow the Spirit of God. And I know one thing, I'll never go wrong if I keep with the book. And I stay in the Spirit with purity and charity. So God has used me. I'm thankful that God has used me. He used me in Bible school to pastor a church. He used me after Bible school in Honduras as a missionary. He's used me as an evangelist and a missionary evangelist. He's using me now through the Cloud Church. And I'm still, when I can, traveling to other places and preach. I just had a guy say, "Brother, come to Guatemala. We need you to preach for a week revival." Okay, brother. I mean, I've gotten into this now where I have to prepare a message in English and in Spanish every week. And then a midweek service teaching verse by verse. So that's three videos a week that I'm into this that I have to do every week. So what I'm trying to do is get ahead several weeks so that when God opens more doors to go here and preach and go there and preach, that I'll have this done also. But I ask you to pray for me. This video is for all of you that have asked, "Brother Breaker, what about the ministry? How do I know that God wants me in the ministry?" Well, I'll tell you, He'll enable you and He'll count you faithful. And if He counts you faithful, He'll just put you right in. It's not something where you just, "I got to do this." It's, I'm just doing right, and all of a sudden, boom, God just puts me right where I need to be. And that's where I believe that God has us, right where we need to be. And I'm thankful for all the people that got saved. I'm thankful for all the people that are learning the Word of God, the truth, through our ministry. And I appreciate that, and I pray for all those that love to attack us. You know, I have some charity. I'm not going to name call you and go down to your level and call you names back. I love you in the Lord. You claim to preach the same gospel as I do. You are my brother in Christ. Brother, have some charity. Have some peace. Have some faith and some purity. Are you even in the ministry? If you think the ministry is God's called me to attack everybody, then you're probably not in the ministry. You're in the flesh, and you don't have any idea what the ministry is. God bless you. We appreciate it. We'll see you next time here on thecloudchurch.org.